back on the Bossman Show, friend of the show, Coach Kyle Keller, Stephen F. Austin Lumberjacks out of East Texas. Coach, how you doing, man? Good to talk to you,
brother. I'm doing great. I'm doing great. Getting ready for Christmas and making sure my wife's buying all the right presents for our little ones.
I hear that, man. Let me ask you this, Coach. How has it been this year, being around more with your wife and kids, you know, with the COVID, being at home? So how was that, man, getting to spend family time with your kids as they grew up here?
Oh, it's been awesome. I tell you, boss, man, this is what we did. We came near you. Not right next to you, but near you. I did a Griswold family vacation this summer.
Wow.
I got a van for my sister, and we jumped in the van. And during the lockdown, and we went for about 2.5 weeks, we went through Florida. And we just took off and driving, and we went to the coast and all the way through into all the way down to the Keys, and then drove all the way back and spent about 2.5 weeks, just the four of us, my wife and my two kids. And we had a great time. We'd never done that before. And we're still together. My wife hadn't left me yet. So
you're a lucky man.
Yeah.
Because, Coach, I've heard a lot of pandemics call a lot of breakups this pandemic. So you get tired of being around everybody all the time. So I've heard, man, for you to make it through, man, hey, you are a blessed brother.
Oh, man. My wife, she's a saint. And so it was a great time. We had a wonderful time. And I felt like we got a lot closer and really got to know my kids a lot better. And I have a 13-year-old daughter and an 11-year-old son, and they're awesome. And we really got to enjoy spending time together, like, you know, catching up, because, you know, you're gone so much. And it's been a wonderful time for all of us. You know, you get two ways to choose to handle all this stuff, right? You can either embrace it and enjoy it and grow from it, or you can get, depression. Like, we're on pause right now. You know, we're not able to play games or practice. And this is the time where I've always felt like our teams always get better. No school, and just focus on basketball. And we're not getting a chance to embrace and get that opportunity right now.
I was going to ask you about that, Coach's perspective for your young men. You know, this year to get games in has been just amazing because of what's been going on all around us. You know, some schools haven't practiced in weeks and played in weeks. Like Wake Forest or Siena or some other friends around the business, we haven't played the games in weeks. So for your guys to play some games, even though it's COVID season, has to be a blessing, though you're on pause right now.
Yeah, we played five. We're going to be about 8 or 9 games behind when we play again. We're going to go 28 days without playing, but when we play our next game, which is probably about as long as anybody. And I hate it for our guys to go that long. That we have going to experience that 28 days. That's a long time between games. But you know, we'll get about a week or so to practice before we play our next game. And our kids have, you know, it's been tough like everybody else. You know, you learn from it. You got to grow from it. I think they've experienced, we've got some older guys who are looking right at their life, right?
Yes.
And saying, all right, where do we want to go with our life? I think there's, you know, they've always been told, hey, this is your schedule. This is what you're going to do. And then they've had a lot of autonomy sitting around. Hey, what am I going to do with my life? So life has hit them really, really square in the nose. And you know, that's a scary thought for someone that's 21, 22 years old, you know, about to get a degree. And what are we going to do? And a lot of anxious moments. And you can't be anxious. You know, you have to try to take control of it. And it's hit them a lot earlier than what they thought it might hit them.
Now, Coach, I'm 33 years old. I tell myself this, Coach, adapt, overcome, and conquer. AOC, adapt, overcome, and conquer, because I saw my staff, Coach, since my birthday party on March 14th. That's when I saw my staff, okay? We had a great time. One last time, celebrate my birthday, of course. But I told them to adapt, overcome, and conquer. We weren't doing interviews via Zoom. We wasn't doing over the phone. We weren't doing virtual bookings. It's all different. So, you're young men. Adapt, overcome, and conquer. You'll be okay through all this negativity around us.
Yeah, the two words we've talked about with our team is flexibility and adjustability. And those are the two things that we've tried to hammer home to our players this year is you have to be flexible because you never know what tomorrow's going to bring, and adjustability. I mean, you know, we came off a season where we were 28-3 and won 15 in a row going into the season, at the end of the season, and, you know, finished 26th in the AP poll. And a lot of people, you know, we had high expectations going into our conference tournament and the NCAA tournament. And so to have that taken away, you know, a lot of disappointment. But obviously there's so many bigger things in life that occurred since March 7th when we played our last game. You know, life changed, the world changed, and we have to adjust to what happened. And you know, you either handle it well or you don't, you grow from it. But in adversity, like you're talking about, that makes you stronger. You grow from adversity. You need adversity to grow. And that's the beautiful thing I think that sports teaches you. And that's what you're doing with your show. You know, you're teaching people about how people grow from sports and what makes sports great.
You got there right, Coach. I'm asking you about March. You know, you couldn't tell your seniors goodbye. You know, that had to suck for them. I had to get the jersey on that one last time and check out the game of hug you and hug the staff one more time. Have that locker room cry together. And that's for it to just be done, over, nothing else. Knowing you had a great team could make some noise and just all of a sudden it's probably an empty void for you and your seniors as well and your team from last year.
Yeah, no question, boss man. You know, we had a great senior night with capping off a great campaign, 19-1 in our league. Actually, we'd gone to 20 games in our league and won the most games in conference history, even though we lost one, won 19 games, and had a great senior night. And one of our seniors, Nate Bain, who made that great layup in Duke, became infamous because he just made a layup, a right-hand layup, right?
Yeah.
To beat Duke. And he proposes to his girlfriend and gets engaged. And then another senior, John Como, plays his last game, or key to our team, really, because he's a great on-ball defender. And then Kevon Harris, who's an all-time leading scorer. So many, many great things. And then we heading to go to Katy, our conference tournament in Houston. And then we get pulled off the bus before our first practice as we're walking into the gym to work out. The tournament's been canceled. So we feed them a great meal after that and then come home. And the staff's kind of splintered. Some of them have gone with their wives back home. You know, the players are still with us. And we walk in the locker room and we get COVID tested for the first time.
Wow.
As we come back and for the very first time to see if anybody's positive for COVID and walk in the locker room. And I tell the guys at that time, I said, guys, I never know when we'll all be together again. I said, but I thanked them for the season and I tear up. I do. I kind of shed some tears and we have never been together. That team was the last time they were ever together without excluding some of the staff. And it was a sad moment, and little in hindsight, it's 2020, you don't know. And, you know, Kevon Harris, who is from Atlanta, signs the two-way deal with the Lakers, and he's out in L.A. They have three of their people test positive for the virus as they're heading – the day camp starting, they shut down. And they're only allowed to bring their guaranteed contracts into camp. They opt out of the G League, so he's left without – any place to go. So he, you know, every other NBA roster, you know, you've got the Hawks hat on right there. So he's locked out of the NBA. So now he's scrambling around trying to find a team right now and has waited around to see if he's going to get drafted or not. I mean, some of us have it bad, but you look at a young man who's the all-time leading scorer here who had waited around all the way till November to play an opportunity to play in the NBA. He chose the Lakers because of their roster situation and what it was. And now he's still trying to find a team to play with. So, I mean, I feel terrible for a guy like that. That was an awful situation for him. But he's a tough kid. He'll make it work.
Most definitely, Coach. And also, man, how was it just trying to make sure just using Zoom to make sure young men was academically engaged with you and your staff personally? Because, you know, when you're back at home, man, you know, it can get to you a little bit. When you used to be on campus, spending that structure, study halls, be with the coaches, working on your game. Now you're back at home now. So how would you use the Zoom to make sure your young men stayed engaged with academically and with basketball and just life in general?
Yeah, probably like every other coach you've talked to. I mean, it was obviously for us, it was different. You know, we're not a huge school. We don't have 50,000 students. We don't have all that kind of stuff. And our resources, I think, are great for a school this size. We've got about 12 or 13,000 students. We have a great academic staff and advisement. And, you know, my staff did a great job of getting us together. And you know, we actually had the best GPA we've ever had here this past spring.
Wow.
We did a great job this summer. But it was a lot of texting, a lot of calls, a lot of Zoom calls, and a lot of online tutoring and through the last couple of months of the semester and our players' credit, they did a great job with that. And obviously, most of them went home. I had a few people stay, a few players to stay this spring, but we finished really well. I mean, you know, I think that's says a lot about the character of our players, the credit of who they are, champions on and off the court, and did really well. And you know, they listened and they wanted to be successful. I think it's hard to be successful off the court if you're not successful. I mean, successful off on the court if you're not successful off. And you know, that's part of leadership. And I think, you know, they wanted to lead. They led in all facets of life. And you know, I will say this, no disrespect to you, to do a Zoom call with you anytime. But, man, I'm sick of looking into my computer and seeing my ugly face. I can tell you that much.
You know, hey, Coach, Zooms are not fun, man. I want to see you guys in person, man. But it's good to see your video and then be on the phone. So it's only that's one good thing about it is that right there, not on the phone anymore. I can't even see you guys when we're talking now. So that's a good thing about Zoom. But y'all there, man, I want to see. Yeah. I miss the game. I miss going to cover games, going to practices. I miss that kind of thing. And I hate the Final Four got canceled. I was looking forward to having you guys all in my city, having you come to the studio in Midtown and with me and talk to me. I had it all played out of my head, Coach, and all of a sudden, canceled. Man,
out
of all years.
Yeah. And I miss coming to Atlanta. You know, I mean, it's one of the great cities in the United States. And I know it was going to be a great Final Four. And I have a lot of great friends there. And my friend Amir Abdul-Rahim is a coach at Kennesaw, getting that thing turned around. And we worked together at Texas A&M. You know, it's and Josh Pastner over at Georgia Tech. And it's a great city. And it deserves to host the Final Four and host it properly. You know, that's the thing about to sell it city. And you know, Atlanta has so many great high school players, and not only just players, but great coaches. And the AAU coaches do a great job of promoting their players there. You know, it's one of the hotbeds of basketball in the United States. And I enjoy getting there every chance I get.
And you had to see the mentioned player you have on your roster now from Pirate Springs on the roster now. So Steve F. Austin loves Atlanta. I know you represent Atlanta. I see you guys on the roster, man. You come this way. A lot of guys, they talk a big game, but you actually get guys to come to your school from the city. That's why I respect you as well.
Yeah, we've had a lot of good players from Atlanta here in the past and need to get some more, that's for sure. And we like it. And kids from Atlanta seem to like coming to school here. And we've had success with it. We need to get some more, that's for sure. And we've lacked probably going back there, but we need to turn this thing around by getting some guys there. Basketball is so competitive there.
And
they know how to play.
Now, Coach, for our listeners out here, tell them about what a coach is about. I talk to this all the time. Being a coach is one thing. That's a title, but you're really a brother, a friend, a father figure, a mentor, a counselor, a therapist. You carry multiple hats under the umbrella of being a head coach.
Well, I think it's hard to coach somebody if you don't love them, first of all. And if you don't love somebody, you can't coach them. And you can't impact their life if you don't love them, if you don't care about them. So it's the X's and O's are just the bottom of the barrel about coaching, I think. But if you don't have that foundation, then, you know, it's kids today, they understand they're so different than what they were when I started 30 years ago. But I think that's always been the same. I think kids respond to when they know you care about them. And there are a lot of ways to show you care about them. I mean, you care about them on the court, care about them doing right off the court, care about them if they're doing well with their families, being responsible. You got to hold them accountable. But they got to, you know, they have to love each other. I mean, they got to love the guy, their brothers in the locker room, and can't be fraudulent. But it's a lot more than what you see on the court is so small, it goes into it. But it's a chemistry. You got to get the chemistry right. Guys got to know that you're very sincere and care about what's going on.
Now, Coach, as far as putting in your stuff, how has that been? And I know when you had those stops and starts, those pauses, getting ramped up, you couldn't play everything you wanted in, you know? So how's it been trying to play more of a scale back with schemes and things of that nature, having a new team this year as well? So how's that been so far?
You know, we probably put in most of our stuff as early as possible, you know, because knowing that we're going to get what you just said, Bossman, it's a great point. we wanted to get the majority, as much of our base stuff in as early as possible, which probably made it, is with the veterans we had, monotonous and probably not as much fun knowing that this was going to happen, because they know. And so it probably wasn't as exciting for them returning. And we focused a lot more this year on offense than we would in the past, because the way we play defense with our pressure, and, you know, we've led the country two of the last 3 years in steals and forced turnovers. We don't get to run a lot of offense in practice because of our pressure. So we really focused on our offense really early in practice. And it's, you know, you wouldn't tell maybe by the last game or two, because we have been very good on offense. But, you know, we've had some injuries and it's not gone maybe according to plan the way we want to. But I think every team goes through struggles and every team goes through hardships. And that's what, you know, you don't become a team, I think, until you have about two or three things happen, and you got to go through adversity. You got to become a family. And until you become a family, you're not a team. And so hopefully as we go through our pause and go through some adversity, we can start becoming a family and start becoming a team. And that's what we need. You know, we need some of this so we can become who we really want to be.
Now, Coach, I told a lot of players who came to me in private, I said, look here, this year going to show you who you're a baller or you not, because you got to love the game this year. It's going to show you who loves the game, because you're on your own a lot. You got to put in your own work, push your own self. You can't just have Coach roll the ball out for you this year. You got to really show it. I love the ball. And this year going to show who really a dog, who not, who's not, Coach.
Boss man, yeah, I agree with you. I mean, our kids, it's funny. You know, I said this about our team a long time ago. You know, this, our team has probably spent more time working outside of when we're required for them to work than any team I've had, in the gym and lifting weights and running extra, and the autonomy of the guys doing stuff on their own. But, man, I agree with you. I mean, you know, not being able to have players over to your house, being around, I think here's one thing I think that's really unique about this year, for us at least in our program, you know, and it probably like every coach has probably told you this, and you've had them on. You have 1,000 coaches on. You're great about promoting the sport. I mean, you're awesome, boss man. I mean, I appreciate what you do for sports, but not having, you know, these kids, a lot of them need, you know, a female role model. They need mother, right? They need some softness after we all yell at them and all those kind of things. And not being able to have them over in our homes, and not being able to have, you know, our wives, not just my wife, but one of our assistant coaches' wives, and seeing children, to me, that's really affected this year, and kids that need nurturing, and because they need, regardless of how 18 to 22, they still need that part of their life.
Yes.
And they're not getting that because of the tier one that these parents are not, these wives are not in that tier one, or these kids aren't in that tier one. And I think that's really affected, you know, the mentality of these kids at this age in this season. And I hate that for them because it's not a normal year.
You got that right. You got that right, Coach. And last one I got for this, man. So, you know, college play is coming up here real soon in January. So are you all playing those back-to-backs on the weekends? How are you going to be setting it up? I know each conference is different this year. So how's it going to be for you guys?
You know, I think that's something that our conference, we're one of the few leagues in America that we went down in how many games we're playing. And we're not playing everybody in our league. We actually played one of our conference opponents, McNeese State, in a non-conference game earlier in the year. That was one of the five games we got in. And we're only going to play 16 games, and we're playing every Wednesday, Saturday. We've got three off dates built in, hopefully make up some games that we'll have. So they had talked about playing, you know, back-to-back through the weekend. That got shelved. So it'll be interesting to see for a team like us, if we can get to 13 games, you know, to qualify. We're in a precarious situation right now. with the pauses. And I think there are a lot of teams that are in that situation, but we certainly are. And, you know, what will really happen? I mean, it's, you know, I was curious as to what happened with Ohio State in the college football playoff, right? What they did, you know, because I think that'll affect a lot of college basketball teams, how many games they get to play and qualify for the NCAA tournament and all those kind of things. I mean, you just saw the other day, all the blanket waivers got passed for in all the sports, you know, and I think the NCAA is really being sensitive to this year and, you know, it's a free year for everybody. And it's just, you know, that I think the sensitivity for what all these kids are going through. And I do think this, I think that, you know, it's a mental hardship what these kids have gone through to try to play sports.
Definitely.
You know, being in the, but it's not normal, but I do think what, you know, the schools are doing to keep them safe is the safest thing to keep them from getting ill, you know, to get the virus. And so I think it's almost a double-edged sword. You know, they're getting to play the sport that they love, but they're having to make some unbelievable sacrifices to do it. And I do think the schools are doing everything possible to keep them safe as well. So it's hey, if you want to do it, hey, here's the choices you have to make to do it, but we're going to do everything we can to make you safe as well. So, I mean, it falls on a choice on the kids if they want to do it or not.
You got that right, Coach.
Because you know what I mean?
Does that make sense?
It does, Coach, because, you know, it's truly, if you want to make this happen, sacrifice. You know, it's all of us that may take it to paying the price right now. I talked to Randy Peels before I got on the phone with you, still talking about sacrifice. So, you know, that's the big word I'm going to tell my staff today, sacrifice. When I talk to my staff today at noon, sacrifice. We got to keep doing that because it's going to pay off in the down the road. If you love radio, if you love basketball, you love coaching, put in the time and work, it'll pay off for you. Get through this COVID thing, man. We'll be okay. We'll get on the other side of this. We'll be greener pastures, Coach. I feel it, man. I feel it in my heart, man.
No doubt, no doubt. And you made a lot of sacrifices, and that's why you've been successful. I mean, you're a special guy, and there's no telling where your career is going to be heading in the next 3 to 5 years. I mean, that's what makes you great.
I'm trying to do my best, Coach, man. Try to give you all a platform, man, because God, I'll tell you, Coach, they don't talk to you guys on a random day in December unless something bad happens. I want to talk to you when something good's happening, when it's not something bad. I want to talk to you. I want to talk to Coach Kyle Keller. Out there, we're still at Austin. I love you guys. So I think that's what this platform is about, man. Give me all a voice when something bad or good happens, when you win a game or two.
There you go, boss man. You're the man. I appreciate you very much.
Coach, same here, buddy. Hey, man, have a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. And I'll talk to you again in the new year, man. And be safe and tell your wife and family say hello as well. And you're the best, man.
Thanks, boss man. Ask some jacks.
You got that right. Coach, be good, bud. Thank you as always, my friend.
Thank you, brother.
All right, now.